I want to give a quick demonstration of the tool I used to make my NES game Lizard and how you can edit levels with it. All you're going to need is a Windows computer and the Lizard source code download. You can get this at rainwarrior.itch.io/lizard. If you purchase Lizard from itch.io, the source code package contains the complete game, but I've also released a fully functional free version containing only the demo content. Everything I'm about to show you will work in the free version as well. To begin, unzip the source code package and go into the Lizard source folder. There's a README text file here with some more detailed documentation if you'd like to dig deeper, but for now double-click on editcampaign.bat. This opens the Lizard tool. You could also do the same by opening the release folder here, then running lizardtool.exe directly, then opening assets-campaign.lpk, but the batch file does this in one step for you. In this main view, you can see four types of game content. On the left are rooms. We'll get to those in a moment. On the right are CHR. This is the raw NES graphics data. Palettes. This is collections of color sets. And finally, sprites, which combine the two of those to make the visual objects and characters you see in the game. Each CHR entry is a collection of 64 8x8 pixel tiles. NES graphics are 2 bits per pixel, which means they are made of 4 colors. You can choose which 4 colors to use by assigning a palette. There's a rudimentary pixel editor here, but most of the time I use these import-export buttons to save or load a bitmap image that I can edit with some other art program like Asprite or GIMP. The palettes are just 4 color collections, and each color picks one of the 64 NES colors. This purple column is actually just black on the NES, but I used it to internally mark some invisible things. Sprites are a little more complicated. These take the 8x8 pixel tiles of the CHR and apply colors from a palette. Each sprite is an assembled collection of colored tiles like this. So at any given time, the NES can have 256 CHR tiles available for sprites. My game organizes that into 4 slots of 64 tiles each, which you can assign CHR data to. Similarly, the NES has 4 active palettes that can be used for sprites, so I can choose those here as well. So each sprite has a tile count, then a list of tiles. I didn't make this super user-friendly. You can't drag tiles around with a mouse or anything, but basically you can mouse over the tile you want in the CHR, then type its hex number here. Then its palette, then its XY position relative to the center. You can click these to flip the tile horizontally or vertically. The grid option can help with positioning. Other options here, minus 16 or plus 16 accesses more pages in case you need more than 16 tiles for a single sprite. Flip does a horizontal flip of the whole sprite. L, R, U, and D shift the whole sprite around by 1 pixel. Up here, VPAL means a sprite has a variable palette, which I'll explain when we talk about rooms. And Bank is used because I eventually had so many sprites and object types in this game that I needed to split them across several ROM banks. 0, 1, or 2 is valid here, though I don't recommend changing a sprite's bank. In general, unless you want to get deeper into Lizard source code, you probably don't want to remove or rename any existing sprites. Editing them is fine, but most sprites in this collection are used directly by game code. For instance, the Lizard's walking animation code depends on this sprite existing with this name. If you remove it, the game will fail to build, unless you remove the code that uses it as well. So now we get to the big one, which is rooms. You can open a room by name here, but normally I go to the Help menu and choose Map. This shows visually the layout of rooms in the world. You can right-click to flip between the two sides, recto and verso. Here's a room. It's a piece of the world, 2 screens wide. These make up the bulk of Lizard's content. Most of the game was made here in this part of the editor. Because this editor was made for my personal use, I haven't really tried to make it slick and intuitive or adapt to different machines and workflows. An immediately apparent problem is that this window is about 1600 pixels wide, and it's not resizable. If you have a 1080p monitor, it should be fine, but users with smaller screens may have a problem here. So near the right-hand side is the CHR and palette selection. You can see two of them. One set is for the background, and there's a separate set for the sprites. These are chosen in a panel at the bottom left. You can also right-click the CHR or palette if you want to quickly edit them. Editing the background is fairly simple. You click a tile and click a color, and then click on the background to draw with that tile. The grid option can help see where the tiles are. Right-click picks up a tile, which is usually more convenient than going all the way over to the CHR selector. Hold Shift and you can draw with color only and not replace tiles. You'll notice this has a blocky effect, using a 16 by 16 pixel grid rather than individual tiles. This is an NES hardware limitation, and it's why most NES games have levels made from 16 by 16 blocks. With Lizard, I tried to carefully hide the 16 by 16 color grid, and sometimes it helps to visualize it directly, which this attribute mode enables. Attribute is the technical term used for the NES's color assignment table. Copy and paste is a little bit awkward. You press the comma key, then right-click to set the top left of a selection. You press period, then right-click to set the bottom right. Then you press K to copy the selection. Then you press L, then right-click to paste it. Notice that color is not copied, only the tiles, but recoloring is generally pretty quick. Z will undo. Undo is pretty important in any editor. It's not very advanced here, but it works for the room editor, at least. For reverting other things, I always had Subversion Source Control to fall back on while I was making the game. In the main window under Help and About, I left myself a list of all keyboard commands because I didn't expect to remember them all. The last thing I should say about the background layer is that tiles from the bottom half of the CHR are solid, and tiles from the top half are open, meaning you can walk through them. There's a collision view to make this easier to inspect. In the top right is a room properties panel. You have map XY coordinates and a recto option to select the recto or verso side of the world. These are used to place the room on the map in the tool, but they don't otherwise affect the game. The ship checkbox was used to mark rooms as finished during the game's production. It causes the room to appear hatched on the map, and any edits will automatically clear this status. Music selects the music for this room, but also its color on the map. Scrolling means the room is two screens wide. Uncheck this, and it becomes a single screen room, and the right half will be unused. I'll show what this looks like in a little bit. Water determines the water level on this screen. If there's no water, it should be 255, meaning it's below the bottom. It will appear as a blue line with the collision view active. A water level of 0 means the whole room is underwater. To produce splash and bubble effects, a room with water should have a splasher in dog slot 10. I'll explain dogs in a moment, but first we'll finish the properties panel with doors. Doors are the links that connect this room to other rooms. Each door has an XY pixel coordinate that the player will enter from when coming from another room. Door 0 is used for testing, to mark where you should begin if you just teleported into this room. And if we have a save stone in this room, door 0 should be placed next to that. Doors 4 to 7 are normally used for the left, right, up and down connected rooms, though they don't have to be. The rest of the doors are arbitrary. Usually, they're used for the doorways that appear in the game that connect the recto and verso sides of the world. You can right-click a door to open the connected room in a new editor window. Okay, dogs. Dogs are what I called all the objects and characters in the game, aside from the player. Most game engines have some concept like this, but I didn't want to use a generic word like object, because it gets confusing with other contexts. You use these same terms for other things. Dog was short and easy to type, maybe fun to say. So each dog has a slot number, a type, an XY coordinate, a generic parameter byte, and a comment. The type is a drop-down field, and there's a lot of stuff in it. It's not alphabetical. Usually, I would just type the first letter of the dog I wanted until it came up. Or for none, I'd press home, since it's always at the top of the list. So you select a type of dog, then type in its position. You can hover the mouse on the map to look for the coordinates you want. If the dog has a visual appearance, you have to make sure the appropriate CHR appears in the right slot. If not, you'll see that it isn't rendering correctly. Some dogs make use of the parameter byte. Slots 11, 12, 13, 14 are normally used to create pass dogs that take you to an adjacent room when you touch them. Note their parameters of 4, 5, 6, 7 here are actually their assigned doors. So these four pass dogs can be automatically generated with the auto link button, but they can be manually removed or adjusted. For instance, if there's a wall in the way and you need an extra slot, you can delete one. The comment field is usually just for making notes, in case that helps for your personal organization, but there's a few dogs that use it in a special way. One of the dogs, Sprite Zero, lets you type the name of a sprite from Bank Zero. This dog doesn't do anything else, it's just a way to add a little visual overlay on the background. Other than a few special dogs like this, the comment field has no effect on the game, and it's just for internal notes you might want to make. The specific slot can matter as well for some dogs. If we put a Skeetle in slot 5, you'll notice it has the wrong color here. This is the VPAL option on its sprite. VPAL means that dogs in even slots use palette 2, and dogs in odd slots use palette 3. This helped me manage colors more easily when making combinations of various dogs. Slot 0 is special as well. Most of the dogs are drawn in random order. This creates the sprite flickering you're probably familiar with from other NES games, as a way of coping when there are too many sprites at once, by rotating which one drops out. However, if you want one sprite to always be on top and never dropped, you can put it in slot 0 where it gets priority. So there's 158 different dogs. You can read about them all in the README text file. They include creatures in the game, other things you can interact with, visual effects, etc. When you want to see how this room actually plays, you can click the Test NES button to try it out. This will build the game and open the NES file produced. Here I have the Mason emulator, but you can use FCEUX or whatever your favorite NES emulator is. Whatever is associated with the NES file type. Note that you start at the door 0 coordinate. If you want to test with a specific lizard, you can select that here. The Test PC button can also work, but there's a bunch of required extra setup. You can check the README text file for details on that. This is a non-scrolling room. Only the left half will appear in the game. Normally, I left a hidden message on the unused right side. This is one of the boss rooms. These will be the hardest to edit because a lot of the dogs in boss rooms are expected to be in specific slots or coordinates. Generally, trying to make non-cosmetic edits to any boss will require a careful review of the code. Finally, going back to the main window, here's a few global tools. In the action menu, you can render a map of the entire game, which ends up in the assets export folder. There's a simple animation preview tool. You just list a few sprites, and it can flip between them. In the File menu, Test NES will test the game, but from the start, rather than a specific room. You can use this to make a finished version of your ROM. So, this editor doesn't do everything. Music and text are prepared separately, and programming is a whole other thing. The README text file has a lot of information on this, but it'll probably become a bit of an adventure if you really want to get into it. So maybe you'd like to play with this and see how an NES game was made. Or maybe you'd like to try the game with a few changes. Or maybe you'd like to replace everything and make a whole new game out of this. So there's a license file with more detail, but basically, if you're willing to replace all the content and aren't using the lizard name or its characters, you're free to do what you want with this, as long as you include me in the credits. Everything except the game content is offered under the Creative Commons Attribution License for this purpose. If you want to make a ROM hack of Lizard, that might be okay with me, but you should contact me about it. I'd probably be fine with a patch release, but I can't give blanket permission here. I would need specifics. Anyway, that's how to use the Lizard tool. It's available for download at rainwarrior.itch.io/lizard, and there's even a free version if you don't already own Lizard and just want to try it out. So I hope you have some fun playing with it, and seeing firsthand how an NES game was made.